A few years ago, I didn't really understand what it meant to invest, which means I definitely didn't know the first thing about where to start when it came to investing. I've always found that word kind of intimidating, and whenever I'd hear about investing, I would immediately think, that's spending money I don't want to spend. But when it came to spending money on something I wanted, I always found a reason, no matter how much it costed. Like, if I had a choice between a $50 stock and a $50 video game, the video game won every single time. And that's how a lot of us are with our money today. So I made this video to shed some light on just how easy it can be to invest. And by the end of this video, not only will you get over your fear of losing money on an investment, but you'll also walk away knowing how to make good money investing even as a beginner, just as I have. Real quick, I have to give you this disclaimer. This is not investing advice. I am just here to give you the information that you've been looking for. I'm not an expert or a financial advisor, but I have made quite a bit of money in investing, and what I'm about to share with you is something I wish I would have learned years ago, because I'd probably be a multimillionaire by now. Anyways, here's the first thing you need to know about investing when you're a beginner. It boils down to two things: your interests and your intentions. Literally, like, majority of your decisions are going to come based off of those two things alone. So when you're getting started investing in the stock market, the first step is to understand that there's multiple ways to invest, and the ways that you decide to invest have to fall in line with your goals. And before I go over a bunch of them here in a second, there's something very important that you need to know. When you invest your money, it's about investing with intention, and that means investing knowing what your goals are for your future way ahead of time. So when I invest with the long term in mind. I want to hold on to it for years, decades. And I'm investing with the image in mind of where I'll be years down the road, because I know that if I make the right investments right now, I know that my money is going to grow in the future. Because that's what it's all about, right? We work hard for the money that we make, so it's only right that we work smart as well and make sure that our money works for us, so we can have the secure financial future that we all deserve. In order to do that, you've got to have a long-term mindset, because investing in the stock market can be a literal emotional roller coaster, because stock prices rise and fall all the time. And if you're not mentally and emotionally prepared for this, I'm going to tell you exactly what's going to happen. You're going to end up being one of those people who loses a lot of money in the stock market, and you withdraw your money way too early, and then you're going to end up being one of those guys complaining about how the stock market is rigged. Nah, bro, your emotions are rigged. Have a seat. Now, since we're already on the topic of investing in stocks, we'll start off by talking about what most of us are familiar with, which happens to be what we're all skeptical about, and that's buying individual stocks, which exist in what we all know is a stock market. When you buy an individual stock, you're buying a very small fraction of a company, which makes you partial owner of a company. So if you decided to pause this video right now to go buy, say, I don't know, a Walmart stock, you would then own a little bite-sized piece of Walmart, which is pretty cool because they're the number one company in the world. But having this partial ownership in Walmart, as Walmart continues to expand and grow as a business, your stock will go up in value, which means more money in your pockets. When you talk about investing in individual stocks, I want you to think high risk, high reward. It's risky because the stock market is known to be unpredictable. Even hedge fund managers and billionaires who are experts can't always time and predict the stock market every single time. And what a lot of beginner investors do is they'll hear of a company that just sounds good, whether it's a tech company or something with a fancy name or something they've heard of before. And they'll invest in the stock thinking they'll see a return, only to find out that it completely flops and they end up losing money on that stock. That's why these famous words exist: only invest in what you understand. And I'll be completely honest with you, that saying used to annoy me to no end. Because in my mind, I'm thinking, how are you gonna tell me, a beginner investor, that I'm supposed to have some pre-existing understanding of something that I don't know much about in the first place? And believe it or not, it was that frustration that held me back from investing for the longest time, because I was convinced that it was going to take me decades to understand what I needed to know in order to invest in the stock market. I mean, of course, there's books and YouTube videos on this stuff, but what do you really mean, I need to understand what I'm investing in? What it means is, are you familiar with the company you're investing in? Let me give you an example. Think of the company Apple. It's an extremely successful company, and it's a very good stock to own for growth purposes. But you know what? If you've owned any items like an iPhone, a MacBook Pro, AirPods, or even an iPod Touch, you're familiar with their products and you know they make good stuff. If you've been consuming Apple products, or if you've just been following them for the past few years, you'll know that they innovate a product like every year. Think about iPhones. Every single time a new iPhone is released, it comes with a feature, a slight feature that the previous iPhone can never have, which makes the newest iPhone look more groundbreaking and revolutionary when it's just another iPhone. Yet, what happens when the new iPhone gets released? People go absolutely crazy for them. And so with that basic understanding of Apple, whenever they release a new iPhone, do you think their stock price is going to go up or down? You get my point? It's understanding where a company is going. It's having a general interest in the company where maybe you've bought their products before. Or maybe you just desire the quality, design, and simplicity of their products. But that's what I mean when I say it boils down to your interests and your intentions. Because one, you're interested in the company and you have some of their products. And two, you want to invest in a stock that grows over time. And while we're on the topic of tech, what do you use Apple products for? Because I use mine to listen to music, surf the web, find information, and use social media. So once you understand that logic behind Apple, it then makes it easier to understand similar companies like Microsoft or IBM. And based off of where you think those companies are going, you can decide if it's a good choice to invest in those or not. Now, here's something else to consider about stocks. If you understand Apple and you understand Microsoft, then you probably realize that whatever device you're using right now is running off of a program developed by either Apple or Microsoft to watch this video on YouTube right here, right now. Even if that's not the case for you, I'm sure you get the point. But now that we're on the topic of YouTube, we all know that YouTube is just a gigantic search engine, right? And it's owned by a larger search engine, Google. YouTube has been on and popping for a very long time, and it's very profitable, and it's owned by Google. What does that tell you about Google? Not to mention the fact that Google has several other devices out there. They've got cell phones, they've got software, and if you're one of those who has an Android phone, that operating system was developed by Google. So what I'm saying is your understanding and interest in one company actually makes it easier to understand other companies, especially when they're similar types of companies, which makes it much easier for you to pick which stocks to buy. This was just a super basic way of explaining what it actually means to understand what you're investing in, but if you really want to dive into this, I would have to make a completely separate video on just the stock market itself and how I make my investment decisions, because there really is a lot more that goes into it. Now, I've covered the most popular and riskiest investment first because I'm sure that's what you came here for, but I also wanted to show you that there's a right and wrong way to approach investing in individual stocks. Some people in the personal finance world would advise against buying individual stocks, but in my opinion, it's just one of many ways to invest. And if you have the means to do so, I think it would be unwise not to explore that way of investing. It takes a little research, but like I said earlier, the higher the risk, the higher reward. It's all going to boil down to your interests and your intentions. I personally invest in individual stocks, but I also invest in multiple other ways as well. If you want to get started with investing, you can check out my link below in the description box. It's a link to Webull. When you download it from below, you'll get two free stocks to get you started. And if you don't know what Webull is a free investing app which makes buying and selling stocks very easy. Now, if you want to talk about a more passive way of investing that's completely beginner friendly, that's literally just as simple as you putting your money in an account and just letting it grow over time. I'm talking getting consistent, solid, predictable returns every single year. You'll definitely want to check out this type of investing, and that's index funds. As complicated as this may sound, this is something that a lot of expert investors, I'm talking millionaires and billionaires, call how to win the loser's game. Because you can always lose money in individual stock investing because it's a higher risk. But what an index fund does is it manages your portfolio with a formula which is designed to mirror an index, hence the name index fund. Now, there's multiple different indexes that are tracked in these funds, but for the sake of this video, I'm only going to go over the three most popular because you might decide you want to check out some index fund and you might see one of these three. So these are the three most common in the US, and that's the S&P 500, Dow Jones Industrial Average, and the NASDAQ Composite. But the most popular of the three is the S&P 500. You might be just like me and say, you know what? I've heard of the S&P 500 before, but I don't know what that is. So I'm gonna break it down for you, you know what I'm saying? The S&P 500 stands for the Standard & Poor's 500 Index, which tracks the top 500 publicly traded companies in the US. So in this case, instead of buying and owning individual stock shares, you're buying and owning shares of an index fund, which means you own like a bucket of stocks. I'm talking dozens, even hundreds, so you get a little taste of everything. The cool thing about this method is it's hands-off. You just put your money in there, you sit on it, and you let it grow slowly over time. Also, pretty much no matter which brokerage you get these from, they're all going to have a low expense ratio, which means you're not spending much money to keep your investments going. Just keep in mind, it's recommended that you put money into your index fund on a monthly basis at the minimum so your money can grow and compound more over time. These are seen as lower risk investments because it's picking several stocks at once. So let's say you have 20 stocks in a bucket, right? And five of them drop in value at once, but the rest of them go up. You're still going to see a return. But if you bought individual stocks and you had 10 shares of Apple and 10 shares of Verizon and they both dropped at the same time, you would feel it because that's putting $2,000 into stocks that have just went down. So it'll be a lot more noticeable for you when your stocks don't perform, and your wallet's going to feel that. Which is why it's so important to diversify your portfolio, which is just investor slang for don't be an idiot for your money, especially if you're a beginner. You've got to have something to fall back on. So if you want to get started with setting up an index fund, make sure you check out the resources I've linked below in the description box. There's plenty of great options out there like Vanguard, Fidelity, Charles Schwab. And the links in the description are going to further break down what index funds they all have to offer so you'll know which options work best for you. Some of them are going to have lower initial investments, while some of the stronger options are going to have higher initial investments. Like the index fund I use is Vanguard's VFIAX, which requires a $3,000 minimum investment. Just make sure you do your research so you know what you're getting yourself into. Which brings me to what I think is the most important part of the video, retirement accounts, because these three accounts that I'm about to go over encompass everything I just said. And it's so important that you get at least one of these accounts as early as possible because it can be the difference between retiring early and not retiring at all. So first off, we have 401ks, which are investment options that your employer hooks you up with, which so happens to be brushed off by a lot of people, especially young people. Listen, if you're in your 20s and you just started working, you need to jump on this opportunity because not enough of us do. Look, this is what made it real for me. Sitting down and helping a bunch of grown men and women in their mid-40s, with families by the way, set up their 401ks for the first time ever and seeing the looks on their faces when they realized how long it was going to take their money to grow so they could retire. And seeing their faces when they learned that they had to invest like double what a 20-year-old would have to invest if they wanted to even think about retiring at the age of 65. And the sad thing is, most people don't have that money to invest. But I think the worst part about not taking advantage of your 401k options is the simple fact that you miss out on free money. Like seriously, if you put just for putting money into your retirement account, your employer puts money in there for free in most cases. Most companies have these things called match programs where they actually match you once you hit a certain percentage that you're putting into your 401k. Everyone's going to have a different percentage you'll have to get with your employer on that, but basically, let's just use this as an example. Let's say you're putting in 8% of your paycheck into your 401k, and that so happens to be where your employer matches you on. The most common match is 50 cents to the dollar, which means for every dollar you put in your 401k, your company's putting in another 50 cents for free. Now, here's where it gets crazy. Check this out. The amount of money that you're putting into your 401k already isn't being taxed. So in this example, we're giving 8% of our paycheck, right? In addition to giving 8% of our pre-tax income to our 401k that is being matched by our employer, which in this case is giving us 50 cents for every dollar we put in our 401k, you'll see just how profitable this can be over time. Think about this. Every $1,000 you put in your 401k, your company just throws in an extra $500 just because. That's free money. Think about this too, because I don't think you heard me. I said that money you've been putting in your 401k hasn't been taxed yet. And we all know how Uncle Sam is when he comes for you with the taxes. He comes straight with the bat, aiming straight for your kneecaps. He ain't playing no games. So when you save on taxes by taking advantage of your 401k option, you see that a good 28% of your income that would have normally been taxed is now saved and put into that investment account, and you can now sit on that for several years and let it grow and compound over time. And that's on top of whatever your employer is throwing in for free. Just remember, when you're ready to withdraw your money from your 401k at 59 and a half, that's when you'll have to pay taxes. Let me go to the next topic before I get mad. So the next thing is IRAs, independent retirement accounts. So in some professions, you actually can't set up a 401k right away. And in some cases, you actually have to wait years so you can set up a 401k. Also, if you don't have a job, like let's say you're self-employed, for example, you won't have the same investment options as someone who's employed full time. And that's cool. I've got a solution for you. Traditional IRAs and Roth IRAs. What's the difference? Good question. Without making this video an hour long, as it probably should be, I'm going to tell you everything you need to know. Traditional IRAs behave just like 401ks do when it comes to taxes. So whenever you put your money in, it's not getting taxed. But when you take your money out at 59 and a half, that's when you get taxed. One difference is with traditional IRAs, the maximum amount of money that you can put into it per year is $6,000 and $7,000 if you're over 50. Whereas a 401k lets you do a lot more at $19,500 at your maximum contribution per year. So kind of a big difference. That tends to even out though because you have way more investment options when it comes to an IRA. Like you have tons of stocks, index funds, and even real estate options that you can choose from in a traditional IRA. Where a 401k actually limits you in terms of what investments you can choose. So what I'm saying is the returns of a traditional IRA can be much more than a 401k because of the simple fact that you have way more investment options to choose from. Then we have Roth IRAs, which are just like traditional IRAs when it comes to the investment options, but the tax advantages are different. So with the Roth, the money that you put in does get taxed right away, but when you're ready to take it out at 59 and a half, you get to take every single dollar tax-free. Because it's already been taxed at the beginning, which I think is a really smart option because we really don't know how much the tax rate is going to go up in the future, especially with everything going on right now. So knowing that you can get taxed now to prevent getting taxed later when you're ready to retire, this could be a very smart option for you, especially if you're uncertain about what's going to happen with taxes in the future. And another really smart option is to have both a traditional and a Roth IRA so you can kind of experience the best of both worlds. Just remember, the max you can give is $6,000 a year. One downside to the Roth IRA is there's an income limit. So as of right now, if you're single and you make $139,000 a year or more, you ain't eligible for a Roth IRA. So that's not even an option for you. Traditional IRAs don't have an income limit, so they're for everybody. I'll be perfectly honest with you, I'm late to the game when it comes to IRAs, and given my current financial situation, I would be crazy not to jump on that opportunity. So you best believe I'm about to start investing in IRAs myself. And if you want to get started with the Roth IRA, you can check out some more of the links I'm going to have in the description. It's pretty much the same place as Charles Schwab, Fidelity, Vanguard, and similar places like that. So in a perfect world, investing in individual stocks, index funds, and a retirement fund all at once is ideal because that is what diversifies your investments and that's how you can make a really profitable future for yourself. That way you can kick back, not have to worry about anything. Take your family on vacation. I don't know. Eat all day, sleep all day. It's the simple things in life for me, but no matter what your goal is, always remember this. Always keep the end in mind when you're investing. Always continue to educate yourself so you can improve and better yourself all the time so that way you can become cold with your money in all aspects. Anyway, that's the video for today. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Reggie Bryant and this channel is all about personal finance and personal growth. If you like the investment content, don't forget to subscribe. I will see you in the next video. Stay cold.